What up guys, Mr. Cybot here, and today we are going to be reviewing this bike right in front of us here. This is going to be the Modenas X Kawasaki Ninja ZX25R Special Edition. That is the longest name I ever needed to say for a motorcycle, so straight off, you guys should know which is the bike that I'm talking about. Currently, it's quite a hot debatable bike here in Malaysia. And it's mostly due to top speed and acceleration and whatnot. You know, they are trying to compare it against their father's EX5, their grandfather's bicycle, I don't know, whatever it is. So anyway, we'll just keep that aside, maybe in a different video. And talking about videos, so if you want to see more videos about this bike, apart from the review, maybe modification, servicing, maintenance, whatever, just make sure you subscribe to the channel, because there will be lots of videos for this bike, because this is the new bike on the channel. Alright, so let's get straight to the review. And first off, this is going to be the 2023 model. Alright, what's the key specs? Or I'm not going to give you everything, all the specs about the bike, because I'm pretty sure you can just Google it anyway. So I'm just going to point out a few key features for the bike overall. For the detailed walkabout for this bike, it will also be on a separate video, so you can definitely check it out on the channel. So I'm just going to briefly run through it, give you guys the insights, and then we're going to do a road test later on. What are the key features that you need to know about this bike? Well, since it's the 25R, we are talking about the 4-cylinder version for the 250cc. Okay, so the fuel tank is about 15 liters. The weight of the bike, with all the liquids in, is roughly 184 to 185 kilograms. It's definitely heavier a bit than its brother, I would say, the normal 2-cylinder Ninja 250R. Okay, so apart from that, what we're gonna have is the TFT display. There's a lot of functions, we'll get into it a bit more closer. So other key features that we want to show is gonna be about the styling of the bike. Is quite nice, okay, it's quite futuristic, or in line with the current modern sport bikes that you have. The tail section, all that is similar to the other brothers of this little baby ZX. It's going to be quite similar to the 636 or the 6R. It's going to be similar to the ZX10R as well, okay. Let's check out the front section of the bike. So for the front section of the bike, what is going to be different is that you will definitely see there's this Ram Air scoop here for the air intake. They are going to be running daylight LEDs light, also for the headlights as well. It's going to be dual, so you're not going to be getting any more of that one eye jack where people are asking you, hey, one of your light, the bulb is not light up, is it burn or something? Which I got it a lot for my old ZX6R. So right now it's all dual lights on, so it's all nice and good. Apart from looking at the shocks, so for this front section here, you will have your upside down shocks. They are going to be the Showa separate function forks, and they are going to be preload adjusted. Okay, you can adjust the preload on it, and that's pretty much it. It's not a fully adjustable front shocks, so very basic here we have. On the front here, also we're going to look at the 2-pot brake caliper, right, from Nissin. It says Kawasaki, but I believe it's actually Nissin. Okay, and you have your single front disc brake, because we are just 250cc, so you don't need a dual disc setup. Let's look at the top section. So over the top section here, you will have also your master pump, Nissin master pump, with adjustable brake levers. On my other side here, you're going to be having your clutch, and also adjustable. So this is one of the cool features, because most of the standard factory clutch levels are fixed. Okay, you can adjust the brake, but not the clutch. So this is very cool for me. And we're going to go follow up next with checking the display console of this bike. For the display, I just mentioned earlier, is TFT, full color digital display. So that's awesome. This is actually my first time owning a bike that is a full TFT. So I'm very pleased with it. It's very easy to see. Let us start it up and I'll show you. So you can see here, there's a lot of features here to see. And if you notice, the startup just now is Kawasaki. So if you guys are a bit confused, hey, how come the tank here is a big, huge Modenas, but meter shows Kawasaki? So basically, this is a rebadged bike, all right? Kawasaki bike, but over here in Malaysia, Modenas rebadge it for pricing purposes or tax purposes. You need to ask them further. So basically, they rebadge it, but everything is a Kawasaki. And let's look at the controls. So on the control side, I showed you the brake earlier. So this is going to be your simple throttle. Your engine, start engine button is to pull down. Yeah, it's not to flick up or down. So you will hold it down to start it and release it. I will do a demo later on, so don't worry about that. We have a select button here. The select here is to choose options that will be for this digital display. So over on this side, the middle here, you will have your usual, the key, which also has the immobilizer system set up. Yep. So you got the immobilizer, the light will blink, showing you it's active. All right. I talked about the shocks. So yeah, it's a Showa separate function, forks, big piston for the SE here. So over on this side, apart from the clutch, you will have your other menu options that you can change up and down, set your laps, high beam, signals, hazards, horns, and behind here is a passing light, okay, to flash when you are trying to pass. So let's go a bit here in the digital here, digital meter here. And as you can see on startup, you have your gear indicator here. On the sides, you have a few warnings. This is like check engine, this is ABS. You have your engine pressure or engine oil, okay? You have also battery, high temp, and just now immobilizer. You have your sport modes, which I will display to you shortly. Then you will have your, that's riding modes, Kawasaki quick shifter, which we will check out in a bit. You got your RPM range, okay, tacho, you got your speedo, trip meters, you have that. You can change the trip to auto. Yeah, so it's like still almost finished braking. You have your temperature, you have some display here that you can also change as you wish to, and a clock. So also fuel, low fuel, and your fuel bar here, okay? Let's check out the riding modes for this bike. So we have the sport mode, and then you hold the down button, your menu button here for a bit, and then it will change to road. It will change to again to rain, and it will change to rider. So you basically have four modes. The difference between each mode is basically the power and the traction control for the bike, okay? So for the rider mode, you can customize it. And the big difference between rider and sport is going to be that in the rider mode, you can turn off the traction control. Sport mode, it's still at this setup, full and one. But in the rider, you can turn off traction control totally if you do not want it. So that's the big difference. And for the other modes, it's pretty much self-explanatory. Rain is if you want it at rain, if it's raining and you want low power. Road is maybe not so full power or something like that. So it's preset modes. But if you want something custom, just go to the rider mode and choose what you want. So checking out the rear section of the bike here. So as you can see, we got a standard muffler still going on. We've got a heat shield, and it's important to have this if you are fetching pillion. Their heel might be touching the heat shield. So if there's no heat shield, they might actually burn their shoes. Okay, apart from that, we have here for the standard edition, the special edition. This comes from Kawasaki, the engine slider or engine guard. For the rear brake of the bike, it's going to be a single piston caliper, also from Nissin, and it's disc brake. For the tires of the bike, so tires of the bike comes standard, the Dunlop Sport Max. On the rear, you have a 160/60, so it's a bit high wall. And on the front, is going to be a 110, okay? The Dunlop tires themselves feel pretty good, so I don't think you need to straight away change the tires right off the dealership. You can just run them and ride them, enjoy them for a bit, so that's nice. For the rear shock, it's running a monoshock as well. It has preload adjustments. And as you can see, it has a pretty unique linkage between the swing arm with the shock. What's cool for the special edition is that it comes with the Kawasaki quick shifter straight out from the factory standard. So that's awesome. And it does the up and down. So it's able to auto blip for downshift and to quick shift for the upshifts. Currently, it's set for the normal gearing. If you want to set up your GP style or race gearing, there must be some modifications and you need to check further if you want to do such a mod, because the shifter itself has a directional sensor and you probably need to make sure that you got it correct or you might damage it. for the chain and sprocket, so the sprockets that come with the bike are from RK out of the factory. And for the sprocket size, it's actually quite huge. It's a 50 tooth sprocket. So what about the power figures for this bike? On paper, it's about 50 horsepower for this bike that it will produce, but the power, max torque is actually quite close to the limit. It's about between 14,000 to 15,000, where the max power and torque is outputted at. So if you want the peak performance, you need to really rev this engine high, and that is the characteristic of a 250cc inline 4. A lot of people don't get it. They'll be like, oh, my bike is faster and whatnot. So if you do not know the characteristic, then it's very hard to explain further. Apart from that, the other aspect that you might want to be concerned is like mileage. For myself, I have been pumping the RON 97 fuel, the expensive one. So roughly I can get about 200 kilometers, not for a full tank, but about maybe 11 something liters. The full tank is about 15 liters. And when the low fuel blinks, it's about maybe 3 to 4 liters remaining in the reserves, and the low fuel will blink. So for me, I usually like to measure when the low fuel blinks. I don't really like to drain the tank until the last milliliter of fuel to give you that number. So to me, 200 is not too bad because you still have reserves. So the minute the thing lights up, I will go and fill it up so the fuel pump is happy, don't have to work too hard. So just want to share a bit on that. I know some guys will say that I can go 250 kilometers and so on, and I'm not saying they are not correct, but I think they are more to like really pushing the limits, maybe to the last 1 liter left in the tank or something like that, which is not my style. I like to keep the bike happy and the fuel pump happy. Here comes the talked about or asked about question whenever a new bike is in the market. So how tall is this bike? Am I too short for the bike? Can I sit on this bike comfortably? So we will address your question straight up right now. The seat height of this bike is about 78.5 cm or 785 mm, whichever measurement you want. My height is 169 cm and my inseam is 80 cm. Okay, so let me get onto the bike and show you a demo of how I look on the bike, whether I'm tiptoeing and whatnot. So let's get it on. Okay, so this is me on the bike. It's actually not that tall, all right? I'm actually having my knees bent a little bit with 2 feet on the ground right now. So definitely no issue for me here. Okay, I know we are a bit on a hill slope, but even on a flat road, it's still fine for me. I even have the cameraman who you guys should know is V. She's about 167 and also no problem to put the feet down. Maybe a little bit tiptoe for her, just a little bit on the heel, but utterly very comfortable, okay? So yeah, just a brief demo for you guys. I don't need to put 1 foot down because 2 feet is already pretty comfortable, okay? As you can see, I'm a happy guy on the bike. Let me get off the bike. And you know what's coming next? Next will be the road review. Let me share my thoughts and opinions for you guys about this bike on the road. Let's get our road review of the Modenas X Kawasaki Ninja ZX25R Special Edition going on right now. Up here in Genting with all the speed bumps, it's gonna be a fun one. So straight up, let's gonna be talking about the riding position. So the overall riding position is on the sporty side, but it's not too extreme. So like compared to maybe a 600 Super Sport, it's not going to be as hunched over or lean forward.
So the bars are a little bit low. Whoever that thinks about want to put clip-ons for even lower, I'm not sure how you're going to do it, because as you can see, the gap between the fairing and the handlebars, the current handlebars, are already quite close to each other. Unless you just want to drop the forks, but I'm not sure about that. So that's a mod that you want to do, that's up to you. Overall, for the riding position on the bike, it's definitely sporty but not too extreme. If you're going to be riding long distance on this type of position, I don't think you're going to have a big problem with it. It's not too compromising for your back. And definitely if you want to, you know, get sporty or feel sporty, you can definitely start hunching down, hiding behind the bubble of this rather short windshield. How about the seat? The seat is actually not bad. Okay, it's not too soft and not too hard. So it gives you just the sweet spot, I would say, for comfort versus being too soft and you know you wanna hang your butt off to do cornerings and stuff, and you think the seat is too soft and it's hard to scoot your butt around. So yeah, it's a good compromise between the soft and the stiff of this seat. So far, thumbs up so far for the overall rider ergonomics. Let's complete our downhill run. So the next thing I want to talk about is throttle response. So throttle response for this bike is nice, I would say, yeah. Obviously you need to correspond it with to the performance or the power delivery when you are putting the throttle, gassing it open. So yeah, this bike, the characteristic of this engine is power at the higher RPMs. And what do you mean by higher RPMs? I mentioned earlier that the peak performance is about 14,000 to 15,000 around there, just almost touching the red line, but not the red line. So where does the power actually start to come? Where do you feel it start coming in from? For myself, what I notice is that if you are going at maybe 8,000 RPMs and higher, as you hit or pass 8,000 RPMs, then you will sort of feel that power coming in. Okay, and I would say that this, as they advertise, the screaming inline 4 definitely lives up to its name. Although right now we do have our stock exhaust, which is like super silent, and the stock exhaust hole is like maybe a 20 cent coin size, okay, with a baffle in the inside. That means if you look into the exhaust straight into the exhaust hole, you can't actually see into the all the way in, okay, into the muffler, because there's actually a baffle that is all for the sound emissions, I think. But even with such a silent exhaust, you can hear the engine screaming. 10,000 RPMs is already like starting to whine, and if you crack the throttle open more, it's going to be screaming. Right now we're going downhill, so I can't actually crack open the throttle. However, since we are going downhill and we are negotiating corners, I would say that the suspension for me, standard. Okay, we haven't adjusted any preloads. As I mentioned in the look about of the bike, there's preloads that you can adjust for both the front and back. So yeah, I haven't actually done any sort of adjustments to it. So this is what the factory standard is, coming from the factory. To me, it's a little bit on the softer side. However, the owner of the bike, if you haven't already known it, it's going to be V that's going to be riding this bike. She says she's happy with the suspension of it. She's not feeling it too soft or bouncy for her. So I'm not going to be stiffening up, because yeah, I want her to enjoy her bike, and if she's happy in this setup, then I'll leave it at this for now. But overall, yeah, I would say out of the factory, it's a little bit on the soft side. However, in terms of the handling of the bike, this is a fun bike to handle for sure, man. Okay, a 250. I haven't been on a 250 inline or a 250 since the last one that I was on, which was the orange one, you guys should know. And I have to say that, yeah, they are really fun, and this one is no exception. Even though it's maybe more heavier than its parallel twin brother or sister, but it's still easy and nimble to flick, so it's really enjoyable in the corners. The tires that come with the bike, I did mention as well, they are the Dunlop Sport Max tires. For me personally, I feel that they are not bad, okay, for a stock tire, and you can definitely run with them. In fact, this bike has already seen Genting twice, and the last time on Genting, if you check the video, the ride video, was in the wet, and they were not bad, although I wasn't doing the riding, I just asked for feedback. So on the higher gears, this bike, like I said, in the lower RPMs, you know, below 6, I think, 6 to 4, it's not too sluggish, but definitely you feel that there's a little bit of a wait time, you know, when you give it a go. It wants to go, but it's like a pending, and the minute it goes close to 8,000, and then you start to feel that surge come in, okay? So this is where you have to understand the characteristic of the bike. I've been saying that a couple of times already, because over here in Malaysia right now, it's quite hot debate, a very hot debate about this bike, because they claim it's the king of 250. To me, I will call it the king of 250 in the sense of it's the only 250 that is inline 4 in its class. Okay, it may have the highest output factory, about what, 50 horsepower, but it depends on where the horsepower comes in, because if you're talking about in the higher range, so that means in the lower range, yeah, you're going to get whacked by maybe R25s or even two-stroker Kibbs with a super modified two-stroker. But I don't know, man, that one to me is going to be a whole other topic. Maybe I'll touch on it on a separate video, because we are just reviewing about this bike right now. I'm not going to like go off topic and start talking about, you know, top speeds and stuff. I didn't actually do a full-on top speed test, but I got pretty close to it running a brief test somewhere in Mexico for acceleration. I was actually more concerned about acceleration of the bike, so that's KQS doing its thing, just testing a downshift on the higher RPMs. Speaking about the downshift, so quick shifter on this bike works great. The user manual recommends to use it after 2.5k RPMs, but to me, realistically, my recommendation is do it after 6. Get to more than 6, and then you can start flicking to the cows come home. Like this, yeah, nice. Then we downshift. So to be honest, guys, for the downshift, I'm not that familiar on doing downshifts just like that, full on, just dropping gears without clutch, because I'm already used to my 6R, and that 6R has no all these fun gadgets for downshifting. So I'm used to like blipping the throttle, although it has the auto blipper going on. It's like contrary to your instincts right now. Maybe if you ride this daily, then you will drop the habit of doing your own auto blipping or blipping yourself. So apart from the auto blipping, the bike also has the assisted clutch. So for the assisted clutch, what happens if you are totally stopped? Okay, if you are totally stopped and you put into first gear and you are trying to go, if you clutch in and you put into gear, your revs will actually go up by itself by a bit. So this is to aid you clutch assist, maybe, I don't know what's the exact term of it. So it's maybe for the new guys who are unsure of how much gas you need to give, or maybe you tend to open your throttle a bit too little while you're trying to get the bike rolling from a stop position. and that's where this one sort of helps you from stalling your bike. So you help it helps you from stalling the engine, so that you can ride without needing to like, oh no, I need to pull alongside and start up the bike. It's a nice feature to have, but it can be a little bit weird for me at certain times, because like, let's say you are at a traffic light stop, you put it into gear but the light hasn't changed, so the RPM is actually went up, because once you put it into gear and clutch in, the RPM, like I said, will go up a bit. I'll do a short demo later if we really have a full stop, or maybe I can just do it right now, guys. Why not? I like to do things on the fly anyway. So let me just show this to you. So as you can see, the RPM is like 2-ish, right? So I put it into neutral, you see it drop. So right now it's like 1 point something, 1.5. And if I clutch in, that's still fine. But the minute I put in the gear, it goes up to 2-ish. Alright, so this is the bike doing its thing, the assist thing or whatever it's called. And imagine if you're doing this and you are at a traffic light and you do it in advance, like before the light turns, then yeah, it's actually like revving up. So next up, let's talk about, since we just covered the revvings and stuff about the engine, let's talk about the heat. So yeah, this is gonna be a big talking point for me for the heat. So as you can see right now, we are on Genting. It's not super cold, it's fairly cool, and we are sort of downhill, so we're not really stressing out the engine too much. And you can see the temperature is like 90 plus, low 90s. However, on the way up, uphill Genting, or even on Karak when I was like maintaining speeds of maybe 130, I can still see that the temperature was like close to 100 or even surpassing 100 at certain points. Maybe it's because of the timing, the weather is like noon weather, you know, almost midday, very hot weather, so the ambient temperature all around you is still hot. Could be that, could be that. But yeah, definitely when I'm looking at the temperature and it's like giving me readings of 100, I do feel a little bit uneasy. And definitely you can feel the heat coming from the bike. So at first, I would have thought that, okay, it's a bit unusual, because, you know, your mind expectation is 250 saja. You know, it's not a big bike, so it shouldn't be so hot, it shouldn't be running so hot. Then later on, you know, you start to understand that, okay, maybe so because it's a 4-cylinder. Okay, the tiny pistons and valves are like working like crazy. Okay, but when we are cruising and you're still going at that high temperature, it gives me a little bit uneasiness on that. For this point, I would have to say I'm actually not too sure. Is it meant to be like that, run hot? If you guys are more knowledgeable, let me know. But to me, I think what I might do is actually just altogether change out the coolant to some more high performance coolant that can really cool this little baby down, because this baby Z screams and gets hot, and yeah, it's a bit uneasy for me for the heat part. So what is it like to ride this bike? It's definitely a fun bike to ride. Most of the bikes right now, the 250 bikes, okay, they all got the looks, alright? You got the looks like your big bros, you know, super bike looks. So this one, same, but the icing on the cake is the sound. Okay, it looks like a superbike and it sounds like a superbike. So what other motorcycle can claim, 250cc bike can claim that? Okay, or even your Kapchai with probably a Bunyi Rabak. Over here we call it a Bunyi Rabak, which is like a very disruptive noise. It's not a melodious noise, or here they will now call the hot term is shadu, Bunyi shadu. Okay, it's a mind soothing sound when you let the little baby scream. But don't try this with real kids, yeah, don't try this with your real baby, your human baby, just this baby ZX. One thing to talk about the sound is a lot of people are also going to be saying about this bike, okay, bunyi pergi dulu. So it's like a, what's the word again? Bunyi macam ribut, pergi macam siput. Sound like a thunder, but move like a snail. So to me, it's a little bit unfair to say that it moves like a snail, because it is what it is for 250. You are not expecting it to like race with ZX6Rs and stuff. That's just nonsense. For me, I'm looking it at the sense of a 250. So how does it perform as a 250? To me, it's not bad. As for the sound, well, it may sound like a reboot, but at least to me, it sounds like a nice reboot, you know, a good, proper, solid, screaming thunderstorm. So the gear shifts are very smooth and crisp, aided by the KQS system. Suspension, like I said, a little bit soft, and right now we are going to be like doing some brake testing. So this one runs with the Nissin monoblock two piston calipers. Got a good feel to it when I'm braking. You can get that initial bite. Yeah, you definitely can get that initial bite if you are grabbing the brake. So definitely a lot of braking power for the 250. Single disc is enough because you're just a 250. Whoa, what the fuck are you trying to do? Dumbass. So as you can see, I'm enjoying the corner, letting the little baby sing. Super nice to flick. Alright, so I think I've pretty much covered my review of the Baby ZX. Let me know if I missed out anything. I'll be more than happy to cover it in future videos. Because yeah, this is not a test bike. This is the next generation bike that is on the Cyborg channel. So definitely there'll be a lot more videos of the Baby ZX, as well as with V, the actual owner of this bike, who's going to be riding it. So that's it for me, guys, for this one here. I hope you enjoyed it. And yeah, like I said, drop me any comments if you've got questions and so on. I'll be more than happy to address them if I can. So till the next one, guys. This has been the Cyborg here. Ride safe and safe ride. There's something that I just want to add just for you guys real quick. Although we already just completed the review, so this is like a bonus track, I guess. Bonus track, special from Cyborg, with love to all of you guys out there. So what I want to share with you guys in this bonus track is about the price. So people are going to say like, hey, lebih baik beli kan? Okay, better we just buy this or buy something else, or buy even just the bigger brother, the 650. Right, you get way more power for sure. Okay, so which one is the one to do? Is it okay to buy? Are you going to rugi? Alright, to me, I think I did actually mention it in one of the comments in previous videos, but I'll just repeat it anyway, since this is part of the review, and I think it's a good point to share. So what's, to me, it's what's important when you want to get a bike like this is your expectation, your needs, your wants, okay? Your expectations. Okay, if you expect this bike to like I said, you want to race with 650s, you want to race with ZX6Rs or whatever, right? R6 and whatnot, then you are having a misguided expectation, because it's just a 250, alright? But if you just want something that is not too powerful, 250, still within the 250 range kind of power, you don't want something that's too heavy, because some super bikes can be heavier, bigger sized, right? So if you don't want all of that, and yeah, you just want something not too crazy in power, not too crazy in performance, Okay. Sits low, right? Only 78 cm, sits low. It gives you confidence, like you're a first time rider. Or not really even a first time rider, I would say. If like you just want to have something in the B2 license class and you don't really want to bother about upgrading, you know, I'm happy. Honestly, if this bike actually existed back then, during my younger times, I would say, I might have just gotten a bike like this and enjoyed for a decent amount of time, I would say. Why? You got the sound, you got the looks, it's all there. You can enjoy it the way you want to enjoy it as a 250. Okay, if people are trying to like hantu you, punching you, you know, like, hey, come la, race with my parallel twin, whatever, you know, bike, RRR, triple R, quadruple R's and stuff, right? To me, it's like, it's not really my concern. I'm not really buying a 250 to race on the streets, to see who has the big top up, the big pickup, the big top speed. I just want to enjoy it. I want to hear it scream. I want to layan the curves, the corners. You know, it might not be the crazy power that your parallel twin bike can produce for the low end torque at least, but at least it's fine for me. So that's my opinion about the bike price at body price at 33,900 Malaysian ringgit, 33,900 Malaysian ringgit before on the road. Okay, that is my thoughts and feelings about it. That's why when I see these comments, these funny comments to me about people like saying, oh, you're gonna regret it and stuff. It's like, I'm pretty sure some people might regret it. You know, if you have your expectations and criteria messed up, you know, you are having some over expectations and then you get disappointed and yeah, maybe you get regrets. But if you know what you're getting into, you know the character of this bike, you know it's not going to be a low-end torque machine. Okay, you know you need to keep the bike revs going up and then you can enjoy it. Then definitely I don't see absolutely any reason why you would feel rugi. And that is my stand, because not because, oh, Cyborg dah beli kan, so of course you must say it's good. It's not that, guys. If you can say that, then literally you have not known me at all. Although I've been on YouTube for like more than 10 years, okay? I have no reason to sedapkan hati sendiri. No reason at all. And with that being said, I think that is one of the important points, I guess, that I really wanted to share as this bonus track for you. So make sure you understand what you need or what you want from this bike, okay? So as long as you are not making over expectations, then you will not need to regret. For the uphills, definitely this bike is a little bit, if you keep the revs up, then it's okay. But otherwise, and like I said, you can see the temperature right now is still close to 100. We are going uphill, yes, I understand, but it's the weather should be a bit more cooling than in the KL city. But you can still see it's covering close to 100, and that was my concern about the heat. So that's it, guys. Thanks for enjoying my bonus track. I hope you did. Catch you on the next one. Till then, one more time, this is the Cyborg here. Ride safe and safe ride.